qualified. I'm still in the tower, and definitely you will find a lot of mistakes and deficiencies in my presentation. I ask you to humbly request you to please forgive me and please give me a blessing so that I can do better in the future. So please forgive me for not coming up to you, your expectations, and maybe even not satisfying you very much, but I'm simply trying to do what Guru Maharaj is asking of me. So please pray for me and give me your blessings. Thank you so much. So the verse I have chosen today is Srimad Bhagavatam, first canto, chapter 5, verse number 23. Because I got inspired by Guru Maharaj speaking about Narad Muni. And I was thinking it would be so wonderful to hear how Narad Muni became such a great devotee. And I have chosen this verse. And hopefully all of you will be enlivened to hear more about this. Let's start with the prayers. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya. Narayanam Namaskrityam Naram Chaiva Narottamam Devim Saraswatim Vyasam Tato Jaya Mudiraye Nashta Prayeshu Abhadreshu Nityam Bhagavata Sevaya Bhagavati Uttama Shloke Bhaktir Bhavati Naishtiki. So here we have the verse right there, and we will first read the Sanskrit, and then we will read the translation and purport by His Divine Grace, A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Prabhupada. So the Sanskrit goes like this. Aham puratita bhave bhavam mune dasyastu kasyaschana vedavadinam Nirupito balaka eva yoginam shushushane pravrishi nirvivikshatam. Translation. O Muni, in the last millennium, I was born as the son of a certain maidservant engaged in the service of the Brahmanas who were following the principles of Vedanta. When they were living together during the 4 months of the rainy season, I was engaged in their personal service. Purport by Srila Prabhupada. The wonder of an atmosphere surcharged with devotional service to the Lord is briefly described herein by Sri Narad Muni. He was a son of most insignificant parentage. He was not properly educated. Still, because his complete energy was engaged in the service of the Lord, he became an immortal sage. Such is the powerful action of devotional service. The living entities are the marginal energy of the Lord, and therefore they are meant for being properly utilized in the transcendental loving service of the Lord. When this is not done, one situation is called Maya. Therefore, the illusion of Maya is at once dissipated as soon as one's full energy is converted in the service of the Lord instead of in sense enjoyment. From the personal example of Sri Narad Muni in his previous birth, it is clear that the service of the Lord begins with the service of the Lord's bona fide servants. The Lord says that the service of his servants is greater than his personal service. Service of the devotee is more valuable than the service of the Lord. One should therefore choose a bona fide servant of the Lord, constantly engaged in his service, accept such a servant as the spiritual master, and engage himself in the spiritual master's service. Such a spiritual master is the transparent medium by which to visualize the Lord, who is beyond the conception of the material senses. By service of the bona fide spiritual master, the Lord consents to reveal himself in proportion to the service rendered. Utilization of the human energy in the service of the Lord is the progressive path of salvation. The whole cosmic creation becomes at once identical with the Lord as soon as service in relation with the Lord is rendered, under the guidance of a bona fide spiritual master. The expert spiritual master knows the art of utilizing everything to glorify the Lord, and therefore, under his guidance, the whole world can be turned into the spiritual abode by the divine grace of the Lord's servant. Om Ajnana Timirandasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshur Unmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Guruve Namaha. Shri Chaitanya Manobishtam Stapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupa Kadamayam Dadati Swapadantikam. I offer my humble obeisances to my beloved spiritual master, by whose infinite mercy my eyes that were tightly shut by the darkness of ignorance have been opened by the torchlight of knowledge. Jai Gurudev. So over here, Narad Muni, and who is in conversation? Vyasadev. Vyasadev has finished compiling many Vedic literatures, but he's not satisfied. At that time, Narad Muni, his spiritual master, understanding the heart of his disciple, arrives to give him more enlightenment and knowledge. And this is the conversation that is taking place between Vyasadev and Narad Muni. And Vyasadev is presenting many questions and Narad Muni is answering. Now here he's explaining about himself. How did he become Narad Muni? You may be surprised to see what a humble beginning he had. Here it is described, he was the son of the most insignificant parentage. His mother was a simple maid servant. She was a domestic help, and she was engaged in the service of great Vedantists, great sages. They had stopped at a hermitage during the 4 months of the rainy season, and she was engaged in helping, in cleaning up, in doing the household chores over there. And her little son, Narad Muni, was just 5 years old. And he also wholeheartedly joined her in engaging in the service of these great souls. And because of this great service that he rendered, he started becoming more and more and more purified. He could eat the remnants of these great sages. He could listen to them constantly being engaged in glorification of the Lord. And simply by being in their presence, Srila Prabhupada says, the wonder of an atmosphere surcharged with devotional service. This is how powerful association of great souls is. It completely purifies one and it awakens the dormant love of God that is there in the souls, in the heart of every living entity. So he had a very humble beginning. If you look at the normal course of events, he probably would have just carried on, grown up, and again been just doing menial service, because that's all he knew. He only saw his mother doing simple menial service. He would have been trained like that. And that's all would have happened in his life. But see what happens in his life because of the power of the association of the great souls. He was not properly educated because she was a very poor, simple, ordinary, humble maidservant. She didn't have much ability to provide, even though she wanted to provide him with much. But because he was in the association of these great souls, his whole life changed. What happened? His complete energy was engaged in the service of the Lord. And who did he become? Narad Muni, the immortal sage. Srila Prabhupada called him transcendental spaceman, because he has the ability to fly anywhere he chooses between the material and spiritual worlds. So this is how this little humble little servant child became Narad Muni. And Prabhupada explains, such is the powerful action of devotional service. This is the power of bhakti, that when we engage in the service of the Lord, we become spiritualized, we become Krishnaized. The living entities are the marginal energy of the Lord, and therefore they are meant for being properly utilized in the transcendental service, loving service of the Lord. When this is not done, one situation is called maya. We are all struggling very hard, isn't it? With the mind and the senses, constantly trying to lord it over material nature, constantly trying to get our desires fulfilled, constantly trying to exploit, manipulate, push, get this, get that. But when one comes to real knowledge, we understand this is simply a waste of time. There is no point in wasting one's time in getting things or getting people or getting goods or getting fame or getting this or that, because it's going to end with the body. And Krishna explains this. He says in Bhagavad Gita 15:7, Mamaivam sho jiva loke, jiva bhuta sanatana, manasistani indriyani, prakriti sthani karshati. The living entities are my eternal fragmental parts. That means we are eternally part and parcel of Krishna. But because we are caught in this illusory energy, what is happening? We are struggling very hard. We are the eternal fragmental parts of Krishna, but due to this conditioned life, we are struggling very hard with the six senses, which includes the mind. So the difficulties of grappling with all the different energies is being brought out in this verse. And here, Narad Muni is showing the way out of this problem. Why should we be in Maya? The illusion of Maya is at once dissipated when we convert our full energy in the service of the Lord. So instead of being involved more and more in sense enjoyment or trying for sense enjoyment, which never ever gets fulfilled or never ever satisfies us, which always is like the donkey and the carrot and the stick, we're constantly being pushed forward. Our senses are always driving us more, more, more. Instead of utilizing our energy in that direction, if we convert all that energy into devotional service, our life can start becoming more and more harmonious, peaceful, successful. Why? Because now we are acting according to our constitutional position. We are coming back to who we really are. No longer we are grappling against a foreign nature. It is not in our nature to be all those things that we are trying to be in conditioned life. It is our nature to be loving and giving and kind and gentle and caring and service oriented when we are in the spiritual energy, isn't it? And with that comes peace. So we want to get more and more spiritualized. We want to get more and more Krishnaized. And Narad Muni is explaining how to do that. So from the personal example of Narad Muni in his previous birth, what do we come to know? It is clear that the service of the Lord begins with the service of the Lord's bona fide servants. The Lord says, service of his servants is greater than his personal service. Service of the devotee is more valuable than the service of the Lord. One should therefore choose a bona fide servant of the Lord, constantly engaged in his service, accept such a bona fide servant as the spiritual master, and engage himself in his, that is, the spiritual master's service. And this is explained again by Krishna in Bhagavad Gita, 4th chapter, verse number 34. What does Krishna say? Tad vidhi pranipatena pariprashnena sevaya upadekshanti tayajnanam jnanina sattvadarshinaha. Just try to learn the truth by approaching a spiritual master. Inquire from him submissively and render service unto him. The self-realized soul can impart knowledge unto you because he has seen the truth. So this is the qualification of the pure devotee of the Lord. And we are now told how to get out of the clutches of the material energy by engaging in the service of great souls. In fact, there's another very beautiful verse. I'm going to ask Lavanya to pull it up. It's from Rishabhdev's instructions to his sons. It's in the 5th canto, 5th chapter, verse number 2, where Rishabhdev explains, the doors to the Vaikuntha planets open up by rendering service to the great souls. Mahat Sevam Dwaram Ahur Vimuktes. Oh, there it is. Tamo dvaram yoshitam sangi sangam mahantaste samachitta prashanta vimanyava surida sadhavoye. What is that translation? It says, one can attain the path of liberation from material bondage. This is the way to get free. Only by rendering service to highly advanced spiritual personalities. So this is the secret of all secrets, Raja Vidyam. These personalities are impersonalists and devotees. Whether one wants to merge into the Lord's existence or wants to associate with the personality of Godhead, one should render service to the Mahatmas. For those who are not interested in such activities, who associate with people fond of women and sex, the path to hell is wide open. The Mahatmas are equipoised. They do not see any difference between one living entity and another. They are very peaceful and are fully engaged in devotional service. They are devoid of anger and they work for the benefit of everyone. They do not behave in any abominable way. Such people are known as Mahatmas. And then in that purport, very briefly, I will read that. The human body is like a junction. One may either take the path of liberation or the path leading to a hellish condition. On the path of liberation, one associates with Mahatmas. On the path of bondage, we associate with those attached to sense gratification and women. So you see how we must get out of the clutches of the material energy is by sincerely, we can go back to the purport, Lavanya, the previous one. We must engage in the service of great souls. Especially, we are encouraged to seek the shelter of a bona fide spiritual master and render service unto him. The self-realized soul can impart knowledge unto you because he has seen the truth. Lavanya, may we go back to the previous verse that we were seeing? Yeah, that one. So here we are explained by service of the bona fide spiritual master, what happens? The Lord becomes happy and he rewards the devotee by revealing himself. Ye yatha mam prapadyante tam stathaiva bhajamyaham. As they surrender unto me, I reward them accordingly, Krishna says in the Bhagavad Gita. Mama vartmanu vartante mana manushya partha sarvashaha. As they surrender unto me, I reward them accordingly. Everyone follows my path in all respects, O son of Pritha. So this is the way we want to take shelter more and more of Krishna by serving the spiritual master. So utilizing the human energy in the service of the Lord through his bona fide representative, the spiritual master, is a progressive path of salvation. And what happens? The whole cosmic creation becomes at once identical with the Lord as soon as service in relation with the Lord is rendered under the guidance of a bona fide spiritual master. The expert spiritual master knows the art of utilizing everything to glorify the Lord. And therefore, under his guidance, the whole world can be turned into the spiritual abode by the divine grace of the Lord's servant. So we saw how merciful and how expert Srila Prabhupada was in engaging everyone. If you read Srila Prabhupada's Lilamrita, you will see how he engaged everyone, neophyte, you know, people who knew something about Krishna, people who didn't know anything about Krishna, people who were completely degraded. Everyone, Srila Prabhupada expertly engaged in devotional service. He knows, because he is the spiritual master, he knows exactly how to engage everyone's propensities in glorifying the Lord. And Srila Prabhupada gives this example. You know, you take a dried gourd, by itself it's useless. You take a piece of string, by itself it's useless. You take a stick, by itself it's useless. But when you tie the string to the stick and you tie the dried gourd to the end of the stick, it becomes an ektara. You can make music with it. So this is how Prabhupada brought so many people of diverse background, nationalities, abilities, consciousness together to make beautiful music for Krishna in the form of ISKCON. So the spiritual master knows very well, because he is directly in touch with the Lord. He knows exactly what is to be done, when it is to be done, how it is to be done, by whom it is to be done. So placing our full faith, in fact, one who has unflinching faith in the words of the Guru, in the Guru and in the Lord, slowly, slowly All the truths of the Vedic literatures are revealed to that person. So we have such a wonderful process of Krishna consciousness. By following that process, we can slowly become more and more and more free of the clutches of the material energy, and we can become more and more fixed service of the Lord. Now, what I would like to do is read just the verses of the subsequent five verses. Can you go back to 125 and just go to all the verses? Yes, there we go. So, would anyone like to read 24, 25, 26? Because this is important for us to see how Narad Muni is describing how these Vedantists blessed him and what were his qualifications and how he made progress. This is very important for us to understand. So who would like to read number 24? Dheeraj Prabhu, would you like to read for us? Okay, Dheeraj Prabhu is not there, it looks like. Agne, would you like to read number 24?
Mataji, shall I read?
Yeah, go ahead.
Although they were impartial by nature, those followers of the Vedanta blessed me with their causeless mercy. As far as I was concerned, I was self-controlled and had no attachment for sports, even though I was a boy. In addition, I was not naughty and I did not speak more than required. Shall I continue?
Yes, please.
Once only by their permission, I took the remnants of their food, and by so doing, all my sins were at once eradicated. Thus being engaged, I became purified in heart, and at that time, the very nature of the transcendentalist became attractive to me. O Vyasadeva, in that association, and by the mercy of those great Vedantists, I could hear them describe the attractive activities of Lord Krishna. And thus listening attentively, my taste for hearing of the personality of Godhead increased at every step. O great sage, as soon as I got a taste of the personality of Godhead, my attention to hear of the Lord was unflinching. And as my taste developed, I could realize that it was only in my ignorance that I had accepted gross and subtle coverings for both the Lord and I are transcendental. Thus, during two seasons, the rainy season and autumn, I had the opportunity to hear these great souled sages constantly chant the unadulterated glories of the Lord Hari. As the flow of my devotional service began, the coverings of the modes of passion and ignorance vanished. I was very much attached to those sages. I was gentle in behavior, and all my sins were eradicated in their service. In my heart, I had strong faith in them. I had subjugated the senses, and I was strictly following them with body and mind.
Okay, thank you. I would like you to click on 29, because this purport is very wonderful, and I want us to read that. So could you just read the translation one more time along with the purport?
Yes, Mataji. I was very much attached to those sages. I was gentle in behavior, and all my sins were eradicated in their service. In my heart, I had strong faith in them. I had subjugated the senses, and I was strictly following them with body and mind. Purport. These are the necessary qualifications of a prospective candidate who can expect to be elevated to the position of a pure, unadulterated devotee. Such a candidate must always seek the association of pure devotees. One should not be misled by pseudo-devotee. He himself must be plain and gentle to receive the instructions of such a pure devotee. A pure devotee is a completely surrendered soul onto the personality of Godhead. He knows the personality of Godhead as the supreme proprietor and all others as his servitors. And by the association of pure devotees only, one can get rid of all sins accumulated by mundane association. A neophyte devotee must faithfully serve the pure devotee, and he should be very much obedient and strictly follow the instructions. These are the signs of a devotee who is determined to achieve success even in the existing duration of life.
Thank you, Lavanya. So you see, this particular verse and paragraph, purport, is very instructive for us. because we have just begun this process of devotional service, because we have just started acting under the orders of the spiritual master, we must know what are the qualifications, what is expected of me, what am I supposed to do, how am I supposed to behave, what are the things that I need to get rid of. It's called anartha nivritti. So here Narad Muni is explaining what was the first thing. He was very much attached to the sages. He was always very happy in their association. He was very faithful. He had strong faith in his heart because he could see that they were completely pure. What was his behavior? He was gentle in his behavior. And in their association, what happened? All his sins were eradicated by serving them. So this is the way we can get purified, by serving the great souls. And because he had strong faith, he followed their instructions. He controlled his senses. And he was strictly following them with body and mind. So these are the qualities that we need to acquire in order to make further and further and further progress in our devotional service and make nice advancement, get rid of our anarthas, get rid of all those nasty things that we have been faithfully carrying in our hearts for millions and millions of lifetimes. Lust, anger, greed, illusion, pride, envy, and all their cousins, all their children, all the things that follow from these. All of these things, we, this whole family, you know, related to lust, anger, greed, illusion, pride, envy, we have been carrying in our hearts for millions of lifetimes. It's not so easy to get rid of our anarthas. So therefore, we need to very strictly follow what the great souls are telling us. Take the medicine. Nati Aushadhi Maya Nasi Baro Lagi Hari Nama Maha Mantra Lao Tumi Magi. To chant the holy name, follow the process of bhakti, and in that, take up what is favorable and reject all that is unfavorable. That we have in the nectar of instruction. Utsah, Dairya, Nischaya, Tat Tat Karma, Pravartanat, like that. So we want to be very enthusiastic. We want to be very determined and we want to have patience in following this path of Krishna consciousness and faithfully follow the orders of the spiritual master. Once we begin doing this, we ourselves will see, oh wow, compared to last year, I'm not so provoked like before. Those little things which used to annoy me so much and drive me nuts, today, I can just shrug them off and say, oh, well, you know. So we can actually begin to see the changes in ourselves. After all, the proof of the pudding is in the eating, isn't it? So when we begin the process and we follow it very sincerely, we follow with great faith and with great attention, and we strictly obey the orders of the spiritual master, anartha nivritti starts taking place. And we slowly get rid of all these things which are choking and blocking our bhakti lata beej from flourishing and coming up nicely. So we want our bhakti lata beej, our devotional creeper, to grow nice and strong, isn't it? So this is the way we can follow this process and become free of all anarthas and become very successful even in the existing duration of life. If we take up this, whatever state of consciousness we are in, whatever age we are at, we can go on to make nice progress in Krishna consciousness by following the footsteps of these great devotees like Narad Muni. Narad Muni, he goes on to explain, further we will see down the line, that he was just 5 years old, so small, and his mother really did want to take care of him, but by the will of Krishna, you know what happened? She got bitten by a snake and she died. Now, luckily, fortunately, because this little boy had been trained nicely by the Bhakti Vedantis, he took their words very seriously and he decided to make his life perfect. He took it as, this is the will of the Lord. He took away my last attachment, and Narad Muni went on to meditate perfectly in a lonely forest. He went through so many different places, the description there. He went through towns, villages, this, that, forest, so on. And then finally, he sat down in meditation, constantly meditating on the words that the Bhakti Vedantis had told him, And what happened? He got to see the Supreme Personality of Godhead. That's how pure he became. Of course, the Lord told him that you will just see me for this little one instant in this lifetime. I regret you will not see me again. But that was enough for Narad Muni. He realized that he has now understood that the Lord is there. I am there. I'm supposed to engage in his service. And he was wonderfully purified by that whole process of engaging in strict meditation, following the words of the Bhaktivedantas. So we also can become completely pure and completely fixed in our service to the Lord by following the path of bhakti. We begin with what? Sadhu Sangha. We come into the association of devotees. We start developing some faith. Why? Because we see all these devotees doing so nicely everything. They're joyful. They're happily engaged. Their lives are becoming better and better in the sense that they're becoming more and more peaceful, in harmony, not in conflict anymore. They're actually beginning to become Krishna-ized. So we start developing faith. So what is that called? Adav Shraddha. Then once we become convinced of this, we start taking shelter of the bona fide spiritual master, and that is called Bhajana Kriya. Once Bhajana Kriya happens, then we act under the orders of the spiritual master to weed out our anarthas, and that is called Anartha Nivritti. Once Anartha Nivritti is, at least 75% of our anarthas are cleared, we reach the platform of steadiness called Nishtha. Once we reach Nishtha, the purification, of course, continues because still there's 25%, but one becomes more and more absorbed in loving devotion and a sweet taste, ruchi, develops. Once ruchi develops, then of course we go on to asakti. That means we cannot not think of Krishna. We just cannot help but think of Krishna and want to serve Krishna and then bhava and then prema. Of course, these are all very elevated stages. We are still in the process of anartha nivritti. Those of us who have got initiated, we have at least come to bhajana kriya. Once that happens, then we can go on to anartha nivritti. Of course, at any point, anartha nivritti can happen because the process of devotional service is so purifying and so potent that even before one comes to bhajana kriya, the process of purification has begun simply by coming in contact with Krishna, simply by chanting the holy names. But specifically, under the orders of Guru, we can make more and more firm advancement towards the goal of life, which is what? Prema Pumartha Mahan, awakening all that dormant love which is there, sitting in our hearts, which is covered over by all the layers of nescience, by all these, you know, so many desires and attachments and fruitive activities and even dislikes and aversions and, you know, all the other things also. Both are equally involved in keeping us covered. Attachment and aversion, both are there. So one by one, all these layers are uncovered and we come to who we really are. Who are we really? Eternal, blissful, full of knowledge, totally in love with Krishna, fully joyful. Eternal spirit soul, Sat Chit Ananda. We are tiny little parts of Krishna. Tiny, very, very minute, very infinitesimal, but having the same qualities as Krishna. So we become Krishnaized. And that's what we want. We want to come back to our original constitutional position and we want to go back home, back to Krishna, instead of struggling endlessly with the material energy, trying to lord it over her, and that can never happen because it is not our position. We are not the proprietor, we are not the enjoyer, we are not the controller, we are nothing. We are just tiny little parts of Krishna meant to serve Krishna. So I think I would like to stop over here and we can open up for comments, questions, realizations, anything you would like to speak. We can all come together to churn the nectar. And I would love to see everybody. If everyone can put on their videos, we can all see each other, brothers and sisters, and have a nice discussion. Thank you very much. Hare Krishna.
Thank you so much, Mataji. Very nice class. Thank you so much. Narada Muni's life is very inspiring always. So in such a young age, he's so fortunate that he got the association of great devotees, pure devotees, and he could realize about making his life perfect and serving the Lord eternally. He could do that. Thank you so much, Mataji. Very nice class today. And devotees have any questions or comments, they can go ahead now. Thank you.
Thank you.
Hare Krishna Mataji, and all pranam. Please accept my blessings. All glories to Srila Prabhupada, all glories to Gurudev. Is he like, you know,
please accept mine. All glories to Srila Prabhupada, all glories to our Gurudev.
Thank you, Mataji. Thank you very much for, you know, talking about Narada Muni. And have this one question, Mataji. Like, you know, in any scriptures we see, like, the Lord has, I can say, utilized Narada Muni to, you know, get in touch with any of the pure devotees or somebody whom he make devotees, like, you know, any pastimes you take, like, you know, Dhruva Maharaj or Prahlad Maharaj, everywhere, all these devotees where Lord wants them to be, you know, protected or brought into this spirituality and make him know of the Lord, Narada Muni is there playing the vital role as a Shiksha Guru or Diksha Guru. So why is it like the significance of why Narada Muni only is been chosen like that for, like, wherever, whichever, you know, scriptures, whichever devotee story you take, I think Narada Muni is there in some form, you know, making them understand the, you know, the Lord's about the Supreme Personality of Godhead. So why Narada Muni got that kind of, you know, benevolent or whatever you call, like, you know, I mean, what is the significance of that, Mataji? Any comment on
that? Yeah, I can share what little bit I know. Maybe it won't be very satisfying and you might want to check with Guru Maharaj and other senior devotees. But yes, you're absolutely correct. Narada Muni is so compassionate and so soft-hearted and so much wants to elevate the conditioned souls. He have Mrigarari the hunter. You know, he told him, why are you doing this? And put him on the path of bhakti. You know, then to the sons of Kuvera, Nalu Kuvera and Manigriva, who are just lost in sense enjoyment. He cursed them to become Yamalarjuna trees. Why? Because he wanted to elevate them. So this way the path to hell is opening up. But if I curse them to become trees, they will at least get to see Nanda Maharaja's son, little Krishna. And they will understand what mistake they have made because they did not forget their previous life, even though they became trees. And so they could understand they have to stand there for 100 celestial years until Krishna delivers them. But that time they got to get purified. And so Narada Muni is completely sold out to the mission of the Lord. What is the mission of the Lord? Bring the conditioned souls back to him. So because Narada Muni is completely in tune with that, he is completely Krishna-ized in the sense that we read just recently, Guru Maharaj did that purport in which he said that practically no difference between Narada Muni and the Lord because he is so much compassionate towards the souls and he so much wants to uplift them and he's so much desirous of bringing them back to Krishna. So Krishna empowers him more and more to do that service. So that is why Narada Muni has such a special position because he is completely sold out to Krishna. He has no other desire except to please the Lord and to unite the conditioned living entities with their eternal Lord and Master. So this is my humble understanding of why Narada Muni is favored so much by the Lord and he helps so many people because the Lord wants him to. And why will the Lord give that favor to Narada Muni? Because Narada Muni is completely, completely wanting only what the Lord wants.
Yes, Mother.
He's totally pure. Yes, he's pure as good as the Lord, you know. Sometimes they say Bhagwan Narada. It's a very beautiful, I don't know, let me see if I have that. Let me see, it's a good question. I'll see if I can read out because Just yesterday, I was looking at this, you know, this Nalakovera Manigriva pastime where Narad Muni, he curses them, but the curse is actually to their benefit because they are so much in the mode of passion and ignorance. And Narad Muni, seeing that, he wants to save them. Let's see. Okay, if someone is able, Krishna is speaking to the two sons, okay, after he has liberated them. If someone is able by chance to see a great saintly person like Narad face to face, who is always serene and merciful to everyone, then immediately that conditioned soul becomes liberated. This is exactly like being situated in the full light of the sun. There cannot be any visionary impediment. Therefore, O Nalakuvara and Manigriva, your lives have now become successful because you have developed ecstatic love for me. This is your last birth within material existence. Now you can go back to your father's residence in the heavenly planet, and by remaining in the attitude of devotional service, you will be liberated in this very life. So you see how simply by seeing the great devotee Narad Muni, their whole life changed and they became liberated. They became great devotees of the Lord, when in fact they were gliding down towards a very hellish existence. As we can see, the path of sense enjoyment, it just degrades us actually, because we are not meant for that. We are not meant to be living like hogs and dogs and cats and animals and camels and asses. We are meant to purify our existence and go back home to Krishna.
Yes, Mataji, thank you. That was very nice, actually, yes.
Thank you. Nice question.
Mataji, there is a question on chat.
Okay.
Hare Krishna, Agni Mataji is asking, Hare Krishna Mataji, please accept my humble obeisances. All glories to Srila Prabhupada. Narad Muni was serving sadhus along with her mother. Did his mother or parents also become great devotees next life?
Good question. Just like Suniti, right? Dhruva Maharaj's mother. There is no mention anywhere that I have read about what happens to Narad Muni's mother after that point where, you know, she gets bitten by a snake and she leaves her body. I have not come across any description of Narad Muni's mother. But no doubt, because her son became such a great soul, and the Lord, you know, purifies 14 and 21 generations of a pure devotee, both up and down are liberated. So very likely they went back home, back to Godhead. There's no description of his father. There's a description of his mother, that she was bringing him up. She was a simple lady, humble maidservant bringing him up. So I have not read anywhere what happened to his mother.
Okay, Mataji. Thank you. Anybody have any more questions or comments? Mataji, I think there are no more questions or any comments from the devotees.
Okay. So thank you all very much for joining in for this class. My humble obeisances to all the assembled Vaishnavas. Again, I humbly beg for forgiveness. Perhaps I have disappointed you today. You were hoping to see Guru Maharaj and here comes Sri Devi Mataji. Sorry about that. But hopefully, by seeing Guru Maharaj's tomorrow, you will again become happy instead of remaining morose. Krishna. Thank you all very much. My humble obeisance. Vancha kalpatarubhyascha kripa sindubhya evacha patitanam pavanebhyo vaishnavebhyo namo namaha. Thank you. Hare Krishna.
Thank you so much, Mataji, for a nice class. Thank you. You really explained very well going on to that other verse also. And Very nice explanation, Mataji. Thank you.
I hope so. Thank you very much for your encouragement.